You can lay down on the tracks, keep the nuke trains out of town. Or you can pour gas on the condo and you can burn it down. So here's a toast to the night. Three cheers and a grunt. That's your part. Hey, hey, hey. Very good. Very good. You got it. Next time we'll all get it, right? And then you can sing with this part too.
To the Earth Liberation Front. The Earth Liberation Front.
Without further ado, Leslie James Pickering.
Thanks everyone, it's great to be here again. And it's really cool to hear about all this great stuff that's going on this month especially. So if I was here, I'd be checking out just about everything I could, so I hope you're gonna do the same. A lot of really important stuff. Jaleel is a good friend of mine, for example. And Attica is a majorly important part of our history here in Western New York. So check out all that stuff. It sounds like there's gonna be a fun thing in the basement with prison. Reenactment, but maybe it's
really
locking people up.
This Blacko International Correctional Facility Halloween night. You're gonna want to be here. Yeah, it's gonna be big.
So check it out. It's all good stuff. Like I said, it's awesome to be here. I'm Leslie. This is me and my wife Teresa and our daughter Eliza. We discovered that we were under a good amount of federal surveillance late in 2012, and I'm going to be telling a story about how we discovered that and what we're doing about it. But there's got to be a little bit of background to get it to lay the groundwork so that you understand what the whole story is. So I'm just going to get started. On October 30th of 1996, this happened. Eco-terror suspected in fires. There was a place called the Oak Ridge Ranger Station. It was a part of the U.S. Forest Service. It was in Oak Ridge, Oregon. And there was an arson attack there that cost $5 million in damages. At the time, something called the Salvage Rider had passed under Clinton. And some of you may remember it or have heard of it, but it was a, you know, a piece of legislation that basically enabled a whole lot of old growth forest that was on national forest land, national public lands, to be broken up into little sections that they called timber sales and then sold off to timber logging companies. They clear cut them, and being public lands on national forests, people typically seem to have the idea that those are areas that are protected, that they're there for us to go camp and hike in. But actually the U.S. Forest Service is underneath the Department of Agriculture. And the Department of Agriculture views these trees like their crops. And if and when they're allowed to do so, and we allow them to do so, they'll go in and they'll harvest these crops and then they'll sell them to the highest bidder, and that bidder makes a lot of money. These trees, these forests, are not like we commonly see around here. Although we do have a couple old growth forests, or patches of old growth forests left around here. The ones out in the Pacific Northwest are very, very different. They're very large trees, and there were many times I would see a log on a truck. I mean, a log on a truck. That's all that would fit on the back of a semi-truck, was just one log, and it would just go down the highway. So big they couldn't fit two on there. There was quite a few times that that would happen, and what you need to understand is at the time, around 96, around the mid-90s, that they had already cut 98% of the old-growth forest in North America. That had already been cut. So a lot of, you know, almost all the forests that we see around here have been cut 2, 3, 4 times and have grown back. And so they're certainly not old growth. There's a couple patches that I'm aware of that exist, but they're very small in this region. And out there, it's kind of a concentration of what was left. But you understand this is only 2% of what was here, you know, before the settlers came. So apparently that wasn't enough. So they passed this thing called the Salvage Rider. They wanted the rest of it. They want every drop, every tree. They want everything, really, when it comes down to it. So they passed this thing, and they started logging like there was no tomorrow. And a lot of environmentalists started fighting back and started climbing up trees, sitting in trees, blocking roads, going into forests, logging roads, doing whatever they could to stop these forests from being cut down. And occasionally it somewhat worked. Occasionally they had some successes, but the majority of the time they weren't really having a full success or much success at all. A lot of times the result would be the trees hauled off to the lumber mill and activists hauled off to jail. And it was a very frustrating situation. The Forest Service would send their police in and they would arrest, sometimes brutalize the protesters and then take them away and then the trees would be cut. People were tired of losing, and so this type of thing started happening. $5 million damage to the Forest Service in one night. And after this, this was the first time the phrase Earth Liberation Front was ever heard, because it was used in graffiti that said Earth Liberation Front on the scene. And not too long after, a sort of declaration type of communique was released, not specifically claiming responsibility for this, but saying, hey, we exist and we're doing this. So I'm going to read some of that if I need to read it. Welcome to the struggle of all species to be free. We are the burning rage of this dying planet. The war of greed ravages the earth and species die out every day. The Earth Liberation Front works to speed up the collapse of industry, to scare the rich, and to undermine the foundations of the state. We embrace social and deep ecology as a practical resistance movement. We have to show the enemy that we are serious about defending what is sacred. That's a box truck about the size of a UPS or a FedEx truck. And this is a view from the sky of what was left of the building afterwards. Obviously, you're not going to accomplish much there anymore. This happened on October 19th of 1998, Vail Ski Resorts. And I'm just going to read the communique because it kind of explains itself. On behalf of the Lynx, 5 buildings and 4 ski lifts at Vail were reduced to ashes on the night of Sunday, October 18th. Vail Incorporated is already the largest ski resort in North America and now wants to expand even further. The 12 miles of roads and 885 acres of clear cuts will ruin the last best lynx habitat in the state. Putting profits ahead of Colorado's wildlife will not be tolerated. This action is just a warning. We will be back if this greedy corporation continues to trespass into wild and unroaded areas. For your safety and convenience, we strongly advise skiers to choose other destinations until Vail cancels its inexcusable plans for expansion, Earth Liberation Front. This cost $24.5 million in damages and gained overnight international exposure for the Earth Liberation Front. There were news agencies from around the world calling to find out this. It was the top news story for weeks on end in late 1998. This is the remains of Boise Cascade's Northwest Regional Headquarters. Boise Cascade is now called Boise and now owns Office Max and a number of other corporations that you might be more familiar with their names of than Boise. At the time was branding itself quite a bit, and almost every sheet of plywood that you would buy had Boise Cascade stamped on it, and almost every sheet of office paper that you would buy came in a package of Boise Cascade. They are the biggest forest product company that existed at the time, and they had $1.5 million arson on Christmas Eve of 1999. I'm going to read the communique. Boise Cascade has been very naughty. After ravaging the forest of the Pacific Northwest, Boise Cascade now looks towards the virgin forest of Chile. Early Christmas morning, elves left coal in Boise Cascade's stocking. 4 buckets of diesel and gas with kitchen timer delays destroyed their regional headquarters in Monmouth, Oregon. Let this be a lesson to all greedy multinational corporations who don't respect their ecosystems. The elves are watching. This is Michigan State University, Christmas Eve, 1999. There was $1 million arson there, also claimed by the Earth Liberation Front, that was focusing on genetic engineering. It was the first time arson had been used to fight genetic engineering in the United States. The ELF takes credit for a strike on the offices of Catherine Ives, room 324, Agriculture Hall at Michigan State University on December 31st, 1999. The offices were doused with gasoline and set afire. This was in response to the work being done to developing nations in Asia, Latin America, and Africa to switch from natural crop plants to genetically engineered sweet potatoes, corn, bananas, and pineapples. Monsanto and USAID are major funders of this research and promotional work being done through Michigan State University. Cremate Monsanto, long live the Earth Liberation Front. This is the inside, if I'm not blocking it, of the office where this research was being done. Again, you're not going to get a whole lot accomplished there anymore. January 2nd of 2001, this is the office, the corporate office of a place called Superior Lumber. Superior was well known within the environmental movement because they were always the ones involved in the worst clear cuts. Superior had, I can show you what they had. Superior had a very special operation, which this is a still from If a Tree Falls, which was mentioned earlier. And if you look underneath the head of the stuffed swordfish, you see this, which is a portrait, a large portrait of a logging helicopter. Superior used helicopters to go into forests that didn't have roads in them, into roadless areas that couldn't be logged because you couldn't get a logging truck in there. They said, forget the logs, or forget the roads and the trucks, we're going to go in with giant helicopters and take these trees out, just pluck them right out of the sky. And that stopped environmentalists from being able to block the roads and therefore block the cuts. So you could sit in the tree, they could just fly right over the tree and then go to another one and take that one out. So Superior, like I said, was involved in quite a few of the most awful cuts that environmentalists failed to stop from being cut. This is the building afterwards. We torched Superior Lumber in Glendale, Oregon on January 1st, 2001. Superior is a typical earth raper contributing to the ecological destruction of the Northwest. What happened to them should shock no one. This year in 2001, we hope to see an escalation in tactics against capitalism and industry. While Superior Lumber says, make a few products and do it better than anyone else, we say, choose an earth raper and destroy them. Earth Liberation Front. This is March 30th, 2001. A commercial SUV dealership, Chevrolet dealership in Eugene, Oregon, called Romania Chevrolet. What that means is they only sell to companies, they don't sell to people. So you're not gonna go there and buy your family SUV at this place. It's corporations that come in, get tax write-offs, you're buying SUVs. A lot of times you see these Hummers now with like a tattoo shop logo on the side of it, and that's because they get actual tax write-off for having this truck, even though they have no use for having a truck. So anyway, this same dealership was targeted earlier, and that, I'm going to go into that in the communique. This, actually I'll talk about it afterwards. I'll read the communique first. $1 million worth of luxury SUVs were torched at Romania Chevrolet. Sucking the land dry, gas-guzzling SUVs are at the forefront of this vile, imperialistic culture's caravan towards self-destruction. We can no longer allow the rich to parade around in their armored existence, leaving a wasteland behind in their tire tracks. The time is right to fight back. Romania Chevrolet is the same location that was targeted last June, for which two Earth Warriors are being persecuted. The techno-industrial state thinks it can stop the growing resistance by jailing some of us, but they cannot jail the spirit of those who know another world is possible. The fire that burns within them burns within all of us and cannot be extinguished by locking them up. In this continuous assault on both the planet and ourselves, SUVs destroy the Earth while the prison system tries to destroy those who see beyond this empty life. We must strike out against what destroys us before we are all either choking on smog or held captive by the state. Take power into your own hands. It's your life. That is another close-up image. So what that communique is referring to is there were two activists, Jeff Lewers and Craig Marshall, who went into that lot one evening and tried to set one truck on fire. It destroyed that truck and damaged the two others next to it. They were being surveilled by the Eugene Police Department and the Oregon State Police already, even just for being anarchists. And so they were being followed that night. They didn't make it too far down the street after the fire started and they were arrested. Jeff Lewers in particular was sentenced to 22 years for damaging one truck, for destroying one truck and damaging two others. That's like many years beyond what the average murderer rapist gets. And at that time, when this action, it cost something like $20,000+ in damages. What that did is sent a sort of a chill through the movement. People thought, well, we can't maybe do this sabotage anymore because we'll be sent to prison for a really long time. Earth Liberation Front combated that by going into the exact same lot, burning every single vehicle in the facility, and getting away with it and releasing that communique. So.
And Jeff served, served what, like 10 years and got out?
He did. He served 10 years and then he ended up getting a sentence overturned and resentenced to just about 10 years and released. But it was a long battle to make that happen. So I just wanted to show those, to lay the context of the background of this whole situation. Those are just six out of three dozen actions that happened between 1996 and 2002 that were claimed by the Earth Liberation Front, totaling up to $350 million in damages altogether, depending on what estimate you look at. During that time, the FBI, at many points, both before and after September 11th, declared the Earth Liberation Front and affiliated organizations as the, quote, number one domestic terrorist priority in the United States. They were pumping a lot of money and resources into finding this group and arresting the people involved in it, but they had very, very few leads because these people were very good at what they did. They actually learned an awful lot from mistakes of groups in the past about how people got busted. They left absolutely no evidence. And then if you look at the government sentencing memorandum on the Operation Backfire case, you can see exactly how they got away with leaving no evidence whatsoever, including no footprints, no DNA, no hair, nothing. And so they spent a lot of time figuring out how to get away with this stuff. And again, the spree was very intense. At the peak of it, you were seeing an average of an action every 2 to 3 months. Damage estimates were about $2.5 million per action, and so this is a very intense battle that was going on that was considered the most costly spree of sabotage in U.S. history. So it's a very significant phenomenon that was existing there in those times. And I was the spokesperson for a group called the Earth Liberation Front Press Office. Now, press office was, I mean, essentially just like opening up a P.O. box and a phone number and an email address and say, hey, send me communiques and I'll help explain why you did this. Don't tell me who you are. I'm not going to try to trace where your mail or where your email comes from. But, you know, obviously you can't speak for yourselves. And you need someone to help get the message out. And we were modeling this after other similar types of organizations in the past that had dealt with the Animal Liberation Front, that had dealt with the Weather Underground, or communiques, or other organizations that they had above ground and underground sort of network that were very just loosely connected through the sense of an underground person could find a public mailing address, email address, telephone number, whatever, and then send their communique that way. But there was no, we didn't know how to contact these people. Nonetheless, these actions were very very sensational. So we got a lot of attention in the media. And as the actions continued, the attention increased. Some of what we saw was comical at first. You know, when an action would happen, they weren't used to doing press on this kind of thing. They would find some silly clip art, fireman hat, and stick it up on the news. They liked that stuff. They get a little bit more advanced. They, you know, would have a fire clip out fireman with some flames. I think this guy's famous. Here's some matches and some fire. You know, they're kind of like, you can tell they're kind of getting warmed up on how they're going to do this thing. And Sanity symbol floating above like a random bush and a toxic waste barrel or something. I don't know what they're going for, but they would constantly come up with this kind of nonsense. Slogans, if you build it, they will burn it. That's a nice one. This is cool. That person was at a grand jury demonstration, and of course, I'm probably here, people are probably familiar with, like, you know, masking up at a demonstration is not all that uncommon. Well, it turns out if you put a mask on at a public demonstration, you could be put on TV and made to look as though you're an Earth Liberation Front member, just to add a little sensationalism to the story. Eco-terror rally. I love those. So anytime that they could get the idea here is that they would eat this up. A piece of graffiti that was left on the scene of an action, even if it's a small action, they get on the news time and time again. They love that kind of thing. They would just put it right up on the news. If they could get a newscaster standing next to some Earth Liberation graffiti, that was like the golden ticket. They could bust out the helicopter camera. Right, so that they could film these things from way up in the sky to show like how big a deal it is. They loved that too. And most importantly, they loved the damage, the destruction. You know, there's something about an image, something that's just destroyed, that just, you know, the media flock to it like flies. They could get something burning, they really put that on the screen a lot. Buildings burning, cars burning, big buildings burning, lots of fire. They love this stuff. And that's what we found out, and that was kind of the idea, you know, but that's what we found out was actually underestimated what was going to, the way that they were going to suck it up. This was on the news all the time, especially in the Northwest. They would do these silly things, like really bad, poorly done damage totals that they would just keep running. So if they didn't have any good news that night, they would just run an ELF damage total. Or they would put snippets from ELF communiques. This one here on the right is from that Romania Chevrolet dealership communique I just read a moment ago. They would actually put those up on the screen. You know, maybe not realizing that there's some people that are going to read that and be sympathetic to it. Even put the ELF guidelines on the screen. Now, these guidelines exist to tell people how to form their own cell and how to take action in the name of the Earth Liberation Front. But, you know, this somehow just like breezed right over the consciousness of these news reporters, and they would just print them on the screen. This is my favorite. The first time that 60 Minutes did a full story on the Earth Liberation Front, they actually contracted some firemen to recreate an ELF-esque incendiary device. They showed you where to place the device in relation to the building, then they lit the device, and then told you how high the flames were going.
How to?
Again, you know, we couldn't have done better promotion ourselves, but, you know, 60 Minutes is doing it for us here. And see, the phenomenon was that they really needed to get as much coverage as possible for this, but they couldn't capture anybody. So they really focused a lot of attention on the few of us, especially myself, who were running the press office, interviews everywhere. Interviews just, they grab you on the street, or they take you into a studio, or they do it in your office, or they do it at a demonstration, or they put you on a debate with a congressman. They follow you to a school where you're giving a lecture and then do an interview afterwards. And they did this kind of nonsense too, with, you know, political cartoons. This is a cool one. We did a video with the press office. It was not an instructional video, not a training video. It was a sort of a public, you know, like, hey, you don't understand what's going on with the Earth Liberation Front because the media just talk about violence and terrorism all the time. They don't tell you the real story. So we're going to give a 15-minute video. You know, of course it's going to be a little rah-rah ELF, but at the same time, it's just going to be like really trying to get you to understand where they're coming from and why they would risk their freedom to do this. So we produced this video. This is a snippet from me walking through the woods explaining why it's important to defend the forest, and they put it up on Fox News as if it were an ELF training video. I mean, I'm surprised they didn't Photoshop like a machine gun in my hand, but that's the concept here. A lot of big news stories, a lot of small news stories. This is National Geographic Television. And even after I was done being spokesperson for the ELF, they still call me up. I just got a call today. They still call me all the time trying to get sympathetic, you know, interviews. They say former ELF spokesperson at this point. This is from last month, a BBC piece that was done on the Earth Liberation Front activity in England, which is super active over there. They just burnt like a $16 million £16 million police weapons training facility that was being built over there last year, or this year, which was extremely big deal. So they did a story over there on that. If a tree falls as mentioned, I was in it. So the media are paying a ton of attention, but the media aren't the only people paying attention. Again, more money is going into anti-terrorism, these industries. Okay, let me back up. At first, if you go back into the 80s with the Animal Liberation Front and with like Earth First, you know, there was sabotage happening. But the feds really didn't care. It wasn't under their jurisdiction for the most part. There's some isolated cases where they were paying more attention, but for the most part, they didn't consider it their jurisdiction. These private companies, it was sabotage, it was property destruction, no one was getting hurt, it wasn't a federal crime necessarily. They weren't viewing it as a federal crime. Well, these companies weren't happy with that. They wanted these cases to be taken very seriously. They wanted these people to be put in jail for a very long time. So they started industry front groups like the Center for the Defense of Free Enterprise or Fur Commission USA or whatever. All these different industry front groups, which were funded, they were nonprofit groups that were given tax-deductible donations by the same companies that were being targeted by sabotage. And so then these groups would go and they put forth their agenda to the public, but they would also spend a lot of time and money and energy on getting legislation passed. So they would pass legislation that was giving special protections and increased consequences for people who were doing sabotage against these companies. And so, as the years went on and these actions got more and more damaging and the movement grew more and more, you started to see more and more attention being paid by the government. By the time the ELF came on the scene, it seemed like it was a whole new story. You're talking millions upon millions of dollars in damages happening over and over again, and no one is getting caught. Well, no one getting caught is interesting, because that's something that I love. I was very happy that no one's getting caught. It was something that we felt like we were winning, and we were, and that's a very good thing. But the bad thing is that the few people who've gone on TV and said that they're happy this is happening and that they support this type of activity are going to end up getting the brunt of the repressive apparatus of the state on their doorstep, literally. So during this time period, I had two full-blown raids from the FBI, which also included the ATF, which is the Bureau of Alcohol, Tobacco, and Firearms. Now it's called the Bureau of Alcohol, Tobacco, Firearms, and Explosives. And also included the Oregon State Police and sometimes other state police agencies, depending on where the action was. But they would raid the house and take everything. And actually during this time period, there were 7 federal grand jury subpoenas served to our press office. Back to back, we were the whole time dealing with resisting grand juries. And then at the end of that, there was a congressional subcommittee subpoena, something we had never heard of, and really nobody we ever knew had ever heard of. It's kind of like a grand jury subpoena on steroids. Consequences were worse. You had to go all the way out to D.C. to do it, and it was all over the news nationally. And in between here and there, and all along the way, you had numerous traumatizing and stressful, uncomfortable situations with individual agents. Some of them took it upon themselves to make it personal, sort of a personal goal to send you in prison. The first time I ever had an interaction with a federal law enforcement agent was this guy, Agent John Comrie with the ATF, and he came right up to our house, and we were gardening outside. This is almost right after the ELF took that first action. Told us that that we would be going to prison for decades. They could find a way to send us to prison for decades, and he said that we were walking on thin ice, and if we didn't end up in prison, we were going to end up dead. It's not an easy thing to deal with. And from there, you end up, they just, randomly behind you in line at the grocery store a few times a week, or across the room at a restaurant, or a few cars behind you when you're driving, or on the bus with you, or, they're seeing you on the street and telling you details about, family health details that only somebody who was watching you intensely would know, and just constantly intimidating and harassing and threatening you. And that went on for a long, over half a decade. Here is search warrant, that's my name. Here's the date it was signed by the judge on the 4th, and it was good through the 14th. They raided at 6 a.m. on the 5th, the day after that was signed. At 6 in the morning, they wasted no time. This is one of the newspaper articles, that's me on the left. That was the front page of the Oregonian. Here's one of the fine gentlemen right here, removing an inkjet printer from our house. Now remember, this is 2001, I think this picture was taken. Now you have some printers and copiers that have some data storage capacity, so they could actually go on a little hard drive that's in these things and pull off some information, maybe, about what you had printed over the last month or something, but not in 2001. There is no data storage capacity in that thing, and the good thing this guy is wearing his latex gloves, because he is so sure he's going to find ELF fingerprints all over that thing. Didn't happen. Here's the back of a vehicle filled with stuff. It's a fax machine, again, no data storage capacity. That is a scanner. That's a keyboard. No data storage capacity there. There is a couple hard drives here. There are some paper files, but a lot of what they're trying to do is take the ability of the press office to operate away from us. They're trying to shut us down. They don't have a legitimate excuse to do that, so they convince a judge that they're going to find some evidence here, even though they already raided once before this time and found absolutely no evidence. And have it in their own documents that they found no evidence in the raid, they were still able to convince to do it again and take away all our stuff once more. Thankfully, we had a lot of support. People sent in computers from around the country. We were back up and operating like almost the next day. Here are some of them leaving our house. I'm going to zip through this part. Burning books. We opened Burning Books on the 40th anniversary of the Attica Prison Uprising as a radical bookstore in Buffalo. I like to view it as a continuation of what I was doing with the press office. We're not just passing on communiques, but we have books and we have literature and movies and a lot of events that sort of pass on the same type of radical information about fighting for freedom and struggling for justice, you know, by any means necessary. And so we've sort of tried to build up a hub of where that information is available. Got a lot of radical books. Again, I'm going to zip through this. If you're ever in Buffalo, please stop by Burning Books and check it out, because I like to think it's a pretty special place. We got radical kids books. Here's some cool stuff over here. Graphic novels on things like Harriet Tubman and John Brown's Reign on Harper Ferry, Nat Turner's Slave Rebellion, all kinds of cool stuff. A whole like children's section and posters and stickers and bookmarks. We do a lot of tabling at festivals and events. In fact, we're going to be tabling this year at the Alternative Fair.
Oh, you are?
So cool. Come and check us out. We're going to have two big tables at the Alternative Fair, so come and check us out there. Unitarian Church, that sounds right, doesn't it?
Yeah, it's the Metro Justice Fundraiser.
Yeah, so we're excited about that. It's our first time doing it. We do a lot of speakers. This is Daka Jawea. He was an Attica brother, survived. He had a whole big trial afterwards. He opened up the first day we opened. He was our speaker there. And then about a year later when he passed away, we actually held his memorial at the bookstore with his family. So that was a pretty big deal. But we have a lot of speakers. I could probably zip through them. Naomi Jaffe, The Weather Underground. Scott Crowe, who spoke here once. Helen Benedict talking about rape in the military is like an anarchist puppet group. Rod Coronado, Animal Liberation Front, former political prisoner. Josh Harper, former Shack political prisoner. Ryan Shapiro is an expert on the Freedom of Information Act. Will Potter, who's author of Green is the New Red. Aaron Dixon, who also spoke here. We'd like to try to get some of the people to come here after they come to Burning Books, so you're probably already familiar with a lot of stuff. He was a Seattle captain of the Black Panther Party. Richard Clark was an Attica brother, also survived. Rachel Wolkenstein's the attorney for Mumia Abu-Jamal. Vicki Law is talking about women in prison and inclusivity of families within the movement. Peg Millett also spoke here. She was a convicted and sentenced for a sabotage spree that happened prior to the Earth Liberation Front, was affiliated with Earth First. Rona Africa, the Move organization, Warren Churchill, and Bill Ayers of the Weather Underground is back there. Most importantly, you should know that Asada Shakur is welcome to come get our fresh local blueberries anytime she wants.
Yeah.
And beginners in the year.
Yeah, really?
Yeah, and if she comes
more than $100 this time.
So that's what we've been doing. And apparently, the government is still paying attention. This man here on the right, he holds the position that J. Edgar Hoover held, the director of the FBI. And this man on the left is the highest ranking FBI officer in Buffalo. In September of 2012, I got word that an old friend living all the way across the country, who I have almost no contact with anymore, got a call from two agents from the Buffalo field office of the FBI asking all kinds of questions about yours truly. Questions included: am I capable of committing direct action? Am I able to influence or manipulate? Am I a loner or an extremist? They mentioned this unsolved ELF action from 2002 that cost $1 million in damages to a U.S. Forest Service genetic research station in Allegheny Forest in Pennsylvania. And they claimed in some weird kind of 1950s style that I was stirring up the youth. Most significantly, though, is that what they really wanted to know at the end of it was who else they could talk to that specifically did not like me. If you kind of get the hint, hint, wink, wink that goes with that kind of question, and if you know the history of the FBI, there's really only one reason why you want to talk to someone who doesn't like somebody, and that's to frame them up or bad jacket them, which is to character assassination, ruin their reputation so no one wants to work with them anymore. So that was the first thing that kind of clued me in. I never actually thought that they stopped paying attention to me, but you know, without any direct contact for years, and now I just run a bookstore, it's a fully legitimate business. I don't get communicated from the underground anymore. In fact, the underground actions haven't really been happening lately. And you know, I kind of figured it was like a much more like laid back type of surveillance, if anything at all. Turns out there was a lot more than even this. The following week or two, I found this in my mailbox. It says Mail Watch on the top, it's got my name there, and it's got a 30-day period which was then active when I found it in my mailbox. I was in the middle of this, just about the middle of that 30 days. Show all mail to supervisor for copying prior to going out on the street. And of course, it's confidential with green highlighter. This was on the back of a half sheet of U.S. Postal Service cardstock, and it was just mixed in with my mail. And I, you know, didn't really know anything about this kind of thing in the past, but I had a friend who had a lot of experience, an attorney friend with a lot of experience with mail issues and grand jury issues and other things, Michael Kuzma, who's spoken here as well. And he, you know, did a little research and came up pretty quickly with the realization that this is what's called a mail cover. Mail covers have been going on for over 100 years. Many, many activists have been subjects of mail covers. And what it is a law enforcement agency goes to the Postal Service with sort of an application. There's actually an application form that they bring to the postmaster and say, hey, we want you to photocopy this person's mail for 30 days and send us the copies. And again, this has been going on a long time. The postmaster has a right to either accept or deny the mail cover. In this case, it was accepted. And they thought, oh yeah, you got a good reason, whatever that is, to copy this person's mail. We'll send it to you.
Is that part of the process that they would let you know about it, or was that?
No, like, that was an accident. I could actually get into that at this point. Yeah, that was not meant to wind up in my mailbox. As you'll see further on down the road, there's actually consequences for exposing a mail cover, which are not minor. There's been some cases, and I did some research into it, where a postal carrier intentionally let somebody know. That person not only got fired, but had legal consequences.
So this could have been intentional, too,
but... Could have, but it wasn't. We actually found out a little bit more about it. In my case, it was a substitute delivery person who was known for screwing up.
Yeah, no screw-ups!
got reprimanded, but apparently still has a job, and didn't mean to do this. But mixed it up with my mail and dropped it in my mailbox on accident, and that's that. This is Bill Hochul. He is the U.S. Attorney for the Western District of New York. He's somebody who would be supervising any grand jury that happens in our region. And in April of 2013, a grand jury was served to a financial institution that my family, myself, and our bookstore all deals with. They wanted all the records. Now, not all grand jury subpoenas are for testimonies, and some of you might know some about grand juries enough. The most common grand jury subpoena that an activist has to deal with is for a testimony. They subpoena you to testify before a grand jury. If you resist, you can be held in jail for 18 months. I'm not going to get into that. If you ever deal with a grand jury, talk to a lawyer, preferably Michael Kuzma, right away. Resist it. Do not cooperate. That's all I have to say about it without going into a whole presentation about grand juries. But this wasn't for a subpoena, it was just for records. They wanted the bank to give them all the records they had on us going back to the very beginning of when we opened the bookstore. And about a month later, we get on an airplane, and this is on my ticket. SSSS, here's a better view. Stands for Secondary Security Screening Selection. A lot of you, I'm sure, have heard of the no-fly list. This is better known as the selectee list, nicknamed as the selectee list. Last time I saw it reported, there were about 14,000 people on this list in the United States. You're allowed to fly, but you're mandated for the utmost security. You have to have a pat-down and one of those machines, those big things that see you naked, that all the controversy was about. And they swab it everywhere on you, and they swab the inside. They open your luggage and swab the inside of your luggage. They do everything that they have on you. And they make it look like you were pulled aside randomly if they can get away with it. That's the thing. And the only way that you know if it was really random or not is this. If you know where to find on your ticket, you can find that those S's on there, you can find out, oh, actually, I'm on a list. And it wasn't random, but they will act like it's random. After we found out about those four things, back to back, we decided that we needed to do something about it legally. We rounded up a legal team and a sort of public outreach team, and we did a big fundraiser in Buffalo where hundreds of people came out and we raised enough money to launch everything that I'm going to talk about from here on out. This is just a little snippet from the fundraiser where I spoke briefly, which is at a place called the First Amendment Club in Buffalo, which is a private club that just happened to have a great name that we use. First thing we did is get a lot of press, told everyone that we could about it. Here's one called the USA versus Leslie James Pickering. It was the cover of the weekly paper in Buffalo, Art Voice. This was the front page of the Buffalo News, singled out for his radical past. I love that there's an awesome picture of the Panthers behind me on there. Very cool. This was, and that was May Day of 2013. Nice. This is the 4th of July, 2013. Front page of the New York Times. They've got a picture of me in front of burning books, and they even reprinted a picture of the mail watch memo that was left in my mailbox. If you go online, they had a whole bunch more stuff on there besides this that they shared, all relating to the case. When the New York Times breaks a story, it works as a news wire service. So stories, some newspapers around the country, they have a contract with them. They just copy-paste their story and put it on their front page. So here's some random version. Here's one in Santa Rosa, the same story, different title, different picture, and they got a nice color version of it. And the letter to the editor was written in there. You see here? I'll read it. Well, clearly this man is a threat. In the photo, a volume of Robin Hood is clearly visible in his bookstore. The anarchy and overthrowing of the government advocated in that book show he must be a terrorist. NBC Nightly News did a surprisingly sympathetic story, and they filmed it at the bookstore, which we love. And the next stage after getting a bunch of media exposure is that we actually went through all the sort of, you know, BS that you're supposed to do, even though we had no faith in it. All the things that do exist out there that the system has to sort of address these kind of grievances, right? So we sent letters and formal complaints to places like the Senate Chairman Leahy and Senator Grassley of the U.S. Senate Committee on the Judiciary, Senator Durbin, Chairman of the Subcommittee on the Constitution, Civil Rights, and Human Rights, Tom Carper, Chairman of the U.S. Committee on Homeland Security and Government Affairs, Kristen Gillibrand, who represents Buffalo in the U.S. Senate, Paul Rand, who's a U.S. Senator known for being a champion of constitutional rights, Blake Fahrenthold, Chairman, House Subcommittee on the Federal Workforce, U.S. Postal Service, and the Census, Mary Ann Gibbons, General Counsel for Vice President of the United States Postal Service, Inspector Michael E. Horowitz, U.S. Department of Justice. We did this thing called the DHS Traveler Redress Inquiry Program, better known as TRIP. So if you have a problem flying, they have this thing that you can fill out. And so they sent us they responded to us. Sure, we'll be happy to help you out. All you need to do is fill out this huge thing that includes the names and social security numbers and all this personal information on all the people you associate with, and then we'll go from there. So we didn't do that. And the U.S. Attorney General, we did have some correspondence back and forth with the Attorney General that went absolutely nowhere. The only thing of all these efforts that we did, and this was everything we could find to do, the only thing that got anywhere at all was that was this right here. Chuck Schumer's office sent a letter to the post office saying, what gives? Why is this happening? No response from the post office whatsoever. So I need to back up in time a little bit to give a little more context. This is something that always makes me happy. In the early 70s, a group called the Citizens Commission to Investigate the FBI actually broke into an FBI office in a small town outside of Philadelphia. They stole every single file in the place, and then they went to a cabin for like a week or two and sorted through all the files and put them into packets that they photocopied and released, mimeographed, and released to the press. Some of the press actually had the gumption to print the stories, forcing the other news agencies to also print them, and it got hugely exposed that the FBI was doing a lot of illegal stuff, monitoring civil rights activists, anti-war activists, and a lot of other people that they just didn't like because of their political views. So journalists and private citizens started using the Freedom of Information Act. They would get little pieces of these documents, and they'd be like, and there was a word in there, COINTELPRO was mentioned in one of the documents. And so they did a Freedom of Information Act request on COINTELPRO. And all these different people were doing that, trying to figure out what COINTELPRO was. And this is just one example. There's also the Church Committee, I'll talk about that in a moment. Here's the Church Committee. this Frank Church, and I want to make sure I'm not screwing up. Senator Frank Church, in 1975, they did a Church Committee which investigated the FBI and the CIA for illegally spying on people and actually had some significant consequences for them. Not nearly significant enough, but he was trying to set them straight in a way, for whatever it's worth. COINTELPRO, which I mentioned briefly, exposed a whole lot of really, really horrible, violent, and deadly, and sometimes things that the government, the FBI in particular, was doing to people in the movement, especially people within the Black Panther Party and the American Indian Movement, but also a number of others. This is Fred Hampton, Chairman Fred Hampton, Chairman of the Black Panther Party, Chicago chapter, and the FBI thought that he was a big threat. They were very worried about him because he was very eloquent, and they wanted to prevent the quote, I'm quoting here, prevent the rise of a black messiah like Malcolm X. They did not want another Malcolm X. They thought Fred Hampton might be that next person. And on December 4th of 69, they had an agent who was placed very close within the party, infiltrator, very close to Hampton, who named William O'Neill, who supplied them with this. This is a floor plan of Fred Hampton's apartment, which features his bed location and all the locations of everything anyone would need to know. They also supplied them with false information. They supplied the Chicago Police Department with false information that the Panthers were stockpiling illegal weapons. Of course, they had some weapons. They were legal, and they would not. They did not amount to a stockpile. The police came in with deadly force. These are bullet holes in the wall. This is his mattress, covered in blood, and that is Fred. Before even announcing the raid, they were outside in the hallway in the apartment building, and they just took a machine gun at waist level and shot all the way across where they thought the apartment was. Then they decided to open the door and announce the raid. They killed Fred and Mark Clark, another Panther who happened to be staying there that night. And as they took him out of the building, they smiled and laughed about it. They were very happy about that. And I show that to give some context of two things. One, about how bad the government can be. And these are things that we've been able to expose. I'm sure there's many other things that have yet to be exposed that they've gotten away with since they essentially act with impunity. But the other thing to point out is that we wouldn't even know about this stuff if it weren't for somebody burglarizing an office, stealing files and releasing it to the press, and then other citizens, private citizens and journalists, using the Freedom of Information Act to pry loose documents from the government, which is a battle in itself. So we are also using the Freedom of Information Act, in my case, to get to the bottom of what's going on. Here is the first thing we got back when we used the Freedom, I'm going to refer to it as FOIA from now on. We used FOIA on the post office to say, you know, what's going on here, what are you doing this, and why. And what they initially sent us was all the mail that I had gotten during that 30-day period. After they photocopied the mail, keep in mind, they delivered it, so I already got this stuff. It wasn't a shock for me to see things like, that's up here, and I'll tell you what this is just to explain how incriminating all this information is. This is correspondence from a tombstone engraving company that I was dealing with my grandfather had recently passed away, and I was arranging the tombstone engraving. A postcard from my stepfather. This is student loan bill. Amazon.com order, perhaps the thing I'm most ashamed of on this whole page. This is correspondence from the nursing home that my grandmother was staying in at the time, step-grandmother. This is kind of weird. I use Freedom of Information Act for research purposes. I've been doing it for years. So if I'm researching something that happened, say, in the 60s, I try to get someone's file as research material. It takes a long time. But I was getting an FBI file from the 60s here, and this is correspondence from the Department of Justice, which oversees the FBI. So the Department of Justice contracted the post office to copy the mail that the Department of Justice sent to me and then send the copy back to the Department of Justice. So this is a piece of letter that they went through all this trouble just to get a copy of the letter that they sent. Here's my water bill. This one is good. Attorney Michael Kuzma, one of my attorneys, sent me a piece of legal mail. If you could look real close, it says legal mail there. It's an additional violation to tamper with legal mail. We appealed. And you always have to appeal with FOIA, and I'll probably get more into that later on. But we weren't just looking for copies of the same mail that they already delivered. We wanted the application from the law enforcement agency. We wanted to know if I had ever been on a mail cover before, if I was currently on one, how many times I had been on one, and any other information. That all of that and much more would have fallen in the scope of our FOIA request. So we actually were granted the appeal in this case. And they sent the same stuff back to us again with a little bit more information. They put the letters into weekly packets and sent it to this address, which is Criminal Investigation Service Center in Chicago. It's part of the United States Postal Inspection Service. So basically, they have a whole office in Chicago that processes mail covers and then sends them out to whatever the requesting law enforcement agency is. Now, of course, they might have so many in the country that they need to do that, but conveniently or not, that also enables them to hide what law enforcement agency was actually requesting the information by just sending this instead of, you know, sending what's really behind this. Also written on here under the confidentiality heading, it says, knowledge of this mail cover may be limited to you or the employee designated by you to complete this request. Under no circumstances should the addressee or unauthorized person, including employees, be informed of this activity, and then it's highlighted. Compromise of this mail cover may result in disciplinary action. And this here is, that's what highlighter looks like when you photocopy it, kind of comes off green. We also use the freedom of information. Well, before I even talk about this, even with that appeal, that's nowhere near satisfying our request. It's not complying with the Freedom of Information Act. They give us a little bit, and when they do that, most people are like, oh, I got a file, and I got 15 pages of it, and then they go home and forget about it. They're throwing you crumbs. That's not what, you know, you always have to appeal, and then you always have to take it even further than that if you really want to get what's going on. So, the appeal was granted, that's what we got, and then that was the end of the non-legal process of going through FOIA. We can take it farther with the law, which I'll talk about in a little bit. We use FOIA also on the TSA, the Transportation Security Administration, which is underneath the Department of Homeland Security, which is responsible for that selectee list I was pointing out earlier. And I'm going to tell the story behind this. When I go to get on that airplane, I first get my ticket, and I'm familiar with those four S's because I had a friend who posted his ticket on Facebook and showed where the S's were, so I was familiar with them. So when I got my ticket, I looked, and there were no S's on it. My whole family passes through the security gate with no trouble whatsoever. We breeze right through the gate, nothing, no incident, nothing. We get to the boarding gate where everyone's gathered around to get on your particular plane, and they start to, it's like they're starting to announce that the plane is coming in, people are getting anxious, they're starting to crowd around the gate. And at that point I notice there's like at least a dozen Homeland Security TSA agents like kind of milling through the crowd, thinking that's not usual, what's going on? A couple of them are right next to us, and we're an all-American family. They just, like, don't suspect us whatsoever, apparently, because they're coming, like, right next to us. And the one guy's, like, standing on his tippy toes to look over my head or my shoulders past someone else, and he says to somebody next to him, "You think it's that guy over there?" And even we can hear everything he says. So we're like, something is going on. So then they, before they start the actual boarding, they make an announcement, and this is the airline employee making the announcement that there are going to be, quote, random security checks. Never mind that we already passed the security gates. They don't do random security checks at the boarding gate. You're already past security, you're in the airport, they don't do that. But everyone just kind of goes along with it and doesn't think a whole lot about it, except for maybe, you know, Teresa and me. And so Teresa and our daughter Eliza go through they select their ticket to get on the plane. Nobody before us is called up for a random security check. They go through, they make it through fine. I scan my ticket, a giant rectangle saying selectee starts flashing. I'm kind of peeking around the corner on the computer screen. It's flashing on the screen. All the DHS agents like swarm me, you know, they search me, they do all the things that they do, except that they didn't have that big like metal detector thing there, but they, you know, did the chemical swabs. They searched through all of our luggage. It took, everyone else got on the plane. We were the last ones on because of this. And no one else was pulled aside randomly. And so what this is when we used the Freedom of Information Act with the TSA, they actually gave us a couple things. This is an incident report, more or less. And there's an arrow here, and there's some down here, but I can just read it to make it simple. It says, selective security information, reporting officer summary, at 6:40 at the Buffalo Niagara International Airport, and, interestingly, down here it says gate 12, or gate 21, and up here it says gate 12. They're not very good sometimes. They screw up quite a bit. You know, this is like, just like a cop filling out a police report, and he'd rather be out there cracking heads, but he's got to fill out a report, so he's just like, he's barely literate in the first place, so he just like writes everything down. It's really quick. So that's exactly what's going on here. So at gate 12 or gate 21, depending on which part you're reading, the United agent told our playbook team that, and these are redactions, These letters and numbers on these black boxes actually refer to exemptions under the Freedom of Information Act that they're citing. They're saying, we're not going to let you read what's under this box because of this reason. And if you look in a law book, you can see exactly what those reasons are. So, United Agent told our playbook team, redacted. I was notified and went to the gate. Passenger and property were screened at the gate. Redacted, somebody stated that there were several employees standing by her podium telling her that something, and they were looking over her shoulder. Somebody also stated that this was a distraction, and somebody was sent down to training for remediation. TSO somebody was sent for remediated training, and then here, interestingly, no media involved. Now, I just find that really interesting because, like, we're in the middle of an airport. There's no media in the place. We're past the security gate, but somehow it's like it has to be mentioned that, you know, they're very interested about whether the media are exposing this or not, or, you know, whether it's being done in secrecy. So that's just something to pay attention to. Here's another page that we got from TSA, and this is a very large box here. So in here would have been a narrative, you know, like somebody's writings, at least a few sentences, maybe a paragraph or two about what had happened at the incident. They wouldn't even let us see a single word. There's other things they blocked out here as well. Again, this is not complying with our request. Mm-hmm. If you take it to court, a judge will have to look at each one of these letters and numbers and then look at the actual document and then say, is this justified or not? But most people never take it that far. When we appealed the TSA, they didn't give us anything else. FBI gave us absolutely nothing. The Executive Office of U.S. Attorneys, which oversees Hochul and the grand jury, gave us absolutely nothing. They didn't comply with our request whatsoever. And I want to show this just for a quick moment because this is the kind of thing that you should be getting back from FOIA, from using the Freedom of Information Act. We use the Oregon state law for this. Or states have laws. New York State has a law, Freedom of Information Law, or FOIL. Oregon State has a law too, and so we used it on the Oregon State Police, which were again present at FBI raids and a whole lot of things I went through back in the 90s and early 2000s. And we said, do you have anything on Leslie James Pickering? And they're not used to getting these documents. These requests are usually just sent to the FBI. The FBI has a lot of experience dealing with these requests, but places like the Oregon State Police and other like random, you know, law enforcement agencies or even the IRS, like, you don't get FOIA requests as much. So sometimes they just end up in the hands of interns in the office. Oh, what is this FOIA request? Give it to that intern to process. Or sometimes it's actually subcontracted out to private companies, which don't really care, you know, what gets exposed and what doesn't. So we got 50 pages back just on Boise Cascade arson, just one of the 3 dozen arsons that happened during the time period that I should have been subjected to. They're like, we found this. They couldn't find anything else. They didn't give us anything else. But they found 50 pages just on Boise Cascade. And this page in particular is the kind of thing you're looking for. I'm going to read some of it just because what it does is if you read between the lines and you understand what's going on here, you really get a picture of what they're up to. On March 21st at 8:25, and again, they're screwing up. That's supposed to be a.m. At 8:25 a.m., the ATF agent John Comrie, who I mentioned earlier, lovely man, attempted to contact subject number one at that address. We were contacted at the door by a female who did not identify herself. We asked the female if we could talk to subject number one. She asked who we were, and we told her we were Special Agent Comrie with ATF and I was with the Oregon State Police. She asked us if we had a warrant. We responded by saying we did not, at which point she slammed the door shut.
Yeah, that's what you do.
Then you go down to the next paragraph, and again, reading between the lines, 8:42 a.m., 8:25 a.m. This is shortly afterwards, and if you know Portland, this is just a few blocks away. Special Agent Comrie and myself then attempted contact with subject number two, and if you look earlier in this 50 pages, you see that I'm subject number two at this address in Portland, Oregon at that time. As we approached the residence, we observed a male and female leaving the area from behind the residence on bicycles. Interestingly, because they were just at this other friend's address moments before here, and it would have been just enough time to get out of the back door from that place before they showed up at this next address. We made contact with an unknown female who told us she would wake subject number two, who's me. The unknown female closed the door and never returned. The female that left on the bicycle returned and asked us who we were And she was also living at, and again, stupidly, that address is right there, and it says also living at, so you know that that address is that address. Special Agent Comrie asked the female if she was subject number three. She confirmed that she was. She informed us that she was with subject Pickering. Now again, I'm not subject number two again, now I'm Pickering. But that Mr. Pickering was late for a meeting and did not want to speak with us. What you're understanding is they're talking about this as if it's an interview, like they came to question us about, or question me about something. This is 2000, we had already been dealing with them for 3 years. We probably already had three or four grand jury subpoenas by that point. They were not coming to question us. They know we don't talk. They're coming to serve grand jury subpoenas. And so what's going on here is that you have a community, a network of houses and individuals who are part of a movement, who know how to resist the feds when they come to the door, and they know how to alert each other to the fact that the feds are going around so that people can avoid grand jury service. And so in this case, as I left my bike at the back of the building and they didn't get me, I was not served. We expanded FOIA request to include the ATF, because again, they were at the FBI raids and I have an extensive history with them as well. ATF denied the request. They gave us absolutely nothing, and this is their explanation as to why. At this time, the above investigation is still open. That's one of the exemptions that they can use to deny FOIA requests. They think that there's actually a law, thanks to good old President Reagan, that that you can even lie. The FBI can lie and say you don't have a file, or any agency can lie and say you don't have a file if they think there is reason to believe that you aren't aware of the file. So essentially, you have to have evidence of some kind in order to convince them that they are, in order to force them to release information. If you just say, hey, I just want to check up and see if I have a file, they're going to say no almost every time, and they're going to use, this is a different exemption, but that's one of them. They're going to use that exemption, and so a lot of people who actually have very large files in the FBI have gotten letters back from them saying that they have no file. And so, this is another exemption. They're saying if the investigation is open at all, that it would hamper the progress of the investigation by releasing information on you, so they give you absolutely nothing. So what, at that point, what we did and what we knew we were going to have to do all along, we just needed to exhaust our legal remedies first, or our pre-legal remedies first, was that we had to sue. Here we are filing a federal lawsuit against the FBI, the U.S. Postal Service, the Executive Office of U.S. Attorneys, which is the U.S. Attorney's Office, and the TSA. And that was on on June 26th of 2013. This is Michael Kuzma.
He's come to the store.
And then, of course, we got some press about that. X-Rack was supposed to sue for FBI data, FBI declines to comment. In that lawsuit, and this lawsuit is ongoing, but in that lawsuit, already, just in the declaration that the FBI released, they're already admitting that they're the ones who had the mail cover going. The FBI sought USPIS assistance in furtherance of a domestic terrorist investigation into eco-terrorism activities by a specific individual, yours truly. So what that means is that they got the post office to copy my mail. And then again, we get news coverage on that. Every step of the way, there's a piece of this information. We try to get public exposure along the way because we try to show people that to not be intimidated, that you can fight back, that you should fight back, that you know that we have the right to free speech, et cetera, et cetera. In addition, we file another lawsuit. This time against the ATF, the Alcohol, Tobacco, and Fire Bureau of Alcohol, Tobacco, and Firearms, because they're just denying outright, and we're going to force them to prove that there's an open investigation in court. Now, keep in mind that the vast majority of these exemptions and that type of letter that I got from the ATF, it's all bullshit, right? They're doing that because they know 90% of the people that they send those letters to are not going to do anything more beyond that. They're just going to drop the ball. They're either going to be happy with the two documents you sent them in the mail that are like 90% redacted, or they're going to be happy with the letter that says they have no file, or they're going to be happy with, you know, or they're going to be terrified by the letter that says they have an open investigation and they're not going to follow up with it at all. That's not the case with us. So we filed a lawsuit against the ATF, and the latest on that is that, and at the same time as that one, we renewed our lawsuit against the FBI. So what that did is kind of started the clock over, just because we were already filing a lawsuit against the Justice Department, which oversees both those agencies anyway. It started the clock over on the FBI. So now that anything that happened between when we filed the first lawsuit and the second lawsuit, now would all that period would be included in our FOIA request as well. So anything that they had responded to, the news coverage that we had gotten or anything like that, would now be included in the FOIA request as well on that. And so, we've been litigating on this for a while, and on September 11th of this year, this is the latest information, September 11th of this year, in the courtroom, the government's attorney representing the FBI and the ATF said that the FBI had, quote, tens of thousands of pages on me. Tens of thousands of pages. And I'm pretty familiar with FOIA requests. As you saw, I use them for research purposes. I've gotten a number of documents. Also, helped people with legal cases where they had a number of FOIA documents involved. Tens of thousands of pages is an extremely large, ridiculously large file. And they were saying that they needed 3 years to process these. 3 years before they release anything. And when my attorney Kuzma, on the right here, said, well, we need a more specific number. Tens of thousands is too vague. You know, is this 20,000? Is this 200,000? What is this? We need to know in order to tell if 3 years is really like an adequate time or if that's just them buying time. And the government attorney at that point said, actually, we haven't finished counting yet, but so far we've counted over 30,000. So a minimum of 30,000 pages that they're processing, and then we finally got them to agree on a release schedule, so they're going to do rolling releases. So at this point, at the end of November, the end of next month, we're going to get our first batch of files processed through the FBI, and that's going to keep going until they're done. The longest possible end is the 3 years. About the ATF, they said they had a, quote, more reasonable amount of files and that they'd be able to process them by the end of this year. So by the end of this year, I'm going to have all the ATF files that they're initially going to give me. That doesn't mean that they're going to give me everything I want. We may have to sue again. And then once we get these documents, you know, we're going to be looking for rights, privacy violations and other rights violations or legal violations that we could then sue them on in a way that's not just about getting documents, in a way that's going to hold them accountable in some way.
Just kind of like how did that process work with the judges? Like a little synopsis of that. So you go in with your lawyer to.
This is a lawsuit, right? It's not like a criminal case.
Yeah.
It's different. So you go in. There's a whole lot of pre-trial, like sort of meetings. A lot of it is they try to leave the client out and they just work between the attorneys. Although my attorneys try to get me in as much as possible, so I've been at almost everything except for when I was out of town. But yeah, you know, the judge, and a lot of times the judge isn't used to these lawsuits. You know, you're used to suing somebody, especially around here with Selena and Barnes and stuff. They're used to like suing somebody who like bumped into someone in the car and then they pretend to get whiplash or something. That's the kind of lawsuit they're used to. But, you know, in fact, the judge that I got, I don't think had ever done a FOIA lawsuit or hadn't done one in decades. And so actually this guy referred to the attorneys because they had way more expertise on this about like how to handle the case at the initial meetings. But there's been a bunch of meetings. Seems like the judge is less sympathetic now than he initially was, probably because somebody talked to him behind the scenes. Nonetheless, although it doesn't seem very, there was never a moment that felt like a victory. What's really happening right now is they're processing tens of thousands of pages of files on me and releasing them to us. So like that's exactly what we were trying to get done. Mm-hmm. And we never actually had to go to the point of like arguing before a judge in court, you know, it was all settled beforehand.
What are these legal fees costing now? Or is it, do you have support or is this just used?
What is it costing?
Yeah, like are you paying for it?
So I'm not really sure. The FBI's normal, and this would be the same with the ATF, their normal charge is 10 cents a page, paper copy, hard copy, but you can get a CD for $15 that has 5,000 pages on it. So I mean, even with tens of thousands of pages, it's not going to cost them a fix.
I guess I was thinking more about your lawyer, but that's interesting too.
So the legal fee. I mean, my lawyers are activists. There's a third attorney who's a sort of a hotshot FOIA guy who's really interested in our case.
It's a precedent.
But it's all pro bono and supported by donations. But again, like this is a multi-year process. Like after we get the documents, we have to sift through tens of thousands of pages, try to find legal violations, and then try to, you know, file other suits on that. So it's going to be a long process. So that's pretty much all that I really had to say tonight. without going on too much of a tirade, but I do want to point out a couple things. This actually wasn't the first time that I've been subjected to a mail cover. Back sometime in the late 90s or early 2000s, I can't really say which one, we were on our porch, and our mail delivery person came up to us as they were delivering mail and asked us why it was that they had to copy down all the return addresses on all of our envelopes. And then proceeded to show us a pad of paper where they had been handwriting these addresses for some time, flipping back pages and showing us. And so we were just like, I don't know. Not sure. Thanks for showing that to us. That's kind of weird. And then, you know, we all went on with our days. Now, keep in mind that this is during a period when I'm getting, you know, when we're dealing with grand jury subpoenas, we're dealing with raids. It would be foolish to think that we weren't under investigation. It was just blatant fact that we were under investigation. So it didn't seem like a huge surprise, although it was kind of funny that we found out. It wasn't a big surprise that, you know, that they were also checking the mail. I mean, communiques could be sent through the mail. Maybe they're trying to trace the communique. Who knows? And it was just one of a number of things that we kind of accidentally found out about that pointed to the obvious. The obvious being that we were under investigation for, you know, they're trying to catch these people that are committing the most costly act of sabotage in the country's history. Like, you know, it wasn't shocking. And we had a different mentality back then. I did, at least. And that was kind of like, I didn't talk a whole lot about how we dealt with FBI repression. I didn't want to seem like I was bragging about all the attention I was getting. And I didn't want to seem like I was afraid and couldn't handle it. So if something like that happened, we just kind of let it go and just kept focusing on our objective, right? And which was, we're going to publicize these radical underground actions, help build a radical underground movement that actually has the power to turn the system around. And I'm not going to focus on dealing with repression because that's like a defensive strategy. I'm going to stay just offensive all the time. And I think that's kind of cool, right? I mean, that's kind of like, you know, it keeps, you know, keeps you focused, it keeps the movement going. It's just kind of, you just take a hit and then you just keep rolling with it. But at the same time, I think what we didn't realize was just how powerful repression would amount to be in our movement in the years that followed. It'd be one thing if the repression was all just focused on a handful of very seasoned activists who were able to handle it, who were able to deal with it and move forward. But as federal authorities got more frustrated and less comfortable with their lack of progress, they decided to broaden the repression out quite a bit. They started repressing a lot of people who weren't very seasoned, who didn't have the ability or the resources or networks in order to resist repression. And you started seeing whole cities like Eugene, Oregon, and Portland, Oregon, just empty of activists. Everyone just took off because they couldn't handle it. Couldn't handle all the repression that was coming down. It really devastated our whole movement. And from like 2000 on, you saw ELF actions, 2002 on, you saw ELF actions almost disappear. Like they immediately took like a pretty big decline. And then the last one now is that I'm aware of that was of any significant size was in 2008. So it's been 6 years at this point since ELF has taken an action at all that I'm even aware of in the US. So, you know, at that, it's all nice to say, let's stay on the offensive when you don't realize how serious of a weapon is being used against you. And what really happens time and time again historically is that governments come in, at first they ignore a social movement, a freedom struggle of any kind, as long as they can ignore it. Hopefully it'll go away. Then when they realize it's not going to go away, they decide to put a lot of resources towards it. And they increase the resources towards it until they scare people off. And if they have to, they do things like what they did to Fred Hampton, or what they did to Malcolm X or Martin Luther King, et cetera, they orchestrate assassinations, they have their hands in assassinations in many cases, and they do all kinds of other illegal and horrible things to people if they have to. They're usually not gonna just go ahead and do that kind of stuff if they don't have to, because it's not worth the risk, if they don't need to place that risk. But nonetheless, there is an enormous amount of power and resources and ability at the hands of the system to stop movements that are actually threatening them. And so when you have a movement that is actually threatening them, it's important to recognize repression for what it is, and that is a very potentially devastating foe. It's a potentially very devastating situation that you just cannot ignore. So, you know, maybe it was the case that a handful of us could have resisted grand jury subpoenas that frequently for decades. You know, I don't know. But But it definitely wasn't the case that the whole movement couldn't do that. Grand juries started happening in other places, and people cleared out, and they stopped being activists, and there was no movement anymore. It was just, and it just kind of went that way. So I think my point is that if you don't resist repression publicly and as actively and powerfully as you possibly can, then that allows them to come in and repress a lot of other people who maybe aren't at the same stage that you're at in terms of resources and ability to resist it. And when you clear out everyone in the movement, then who are you even talking to anymore? Not working with anyone, you're going nowhere, it's over. Or at least for the time being, it's over. It's very important that when something like this happens, if someone gets a grand jury subpoena, or even if it's a local case, someone gets a little, like a local civil disobedience case, or a police brutality case or something like that, that the community really steps up and supports that person as much as they possibly can, right? That they do everything that they can do to fight back and to show the system that this is not acceptable. And that's what we're trying to do in our case. And another thing that is very, very important is to never forget what it is that you stand for, why you got involved in this movement in the first place, what it is you really believe, what it is you're fighting for. Because a lot of times when repression sets in, you're not thinking about what you stand for anymore, or why you got involved, or what you believe in, and what you're fighting for anymore. You're thinking about, holy shit, I could end up in prison a long time. You're thinking about, I don't know how I can pay my lawyer fees, or I don't know if I can stand up during a grand jury questioning session, or anything else that might be stressful or personally sort of trying, tribulating to you. So, and that's when people flip. That's when people decide that they're going to cooperate, or they commit suicide, or they leave town, or they otherwise stop being an activist. When they forget what it is that they stand for. If you can keep in front of your mind what it is that you stand for, what it is you believe, you can remember that the earth is being killed if that's what your cause is, or you can remember that there's inequality for women, there's inequality for other races, that this system is just completely rotten to the fucking core, then you can keep that in your mind, then maybe you're going to be able to resist repression a lot more, because you'll always remember that that's not a big bad wolf that's out there trying to get made, that is actually a very, that's not like God. This is what I'm trying to say. That's not God that's going to put me in prison. That's not an almighty power that can do anything it wants for me to put me in prison. That's actually like a horrible entity that's responsible for everything I've been fighting against all along. Now that they're attacking me, I'm still fighting against that same horrible apparatus that I've been fighting against when I was burning down timber companies, or when I was sitting in at a protest, or when I was holding signs, or when I signed a petition. That's exactly what you've been asking for. This whole time you want a confrontation, you want to bring confrontation up, you want to stand up and fight back. Well, when they repress you, that's your best opportunity to stand up and fight back. Mm-hmm. They're coming to your doorstep, and that's the ultimate challenge. And if you fail to resist, then you fail altogether. And I just think it's very, very, very important that as a community, when we see someone resisting, regardless of whether we like them or agree with them or are part of their movement, or they're your best friend or not, that we show solidarity, because what it does to the system is it shuts them down. If they come for one person somewhere, they're going to come for you next. And if that works for them this time, it's going to work for them better next time. If it doesn't work for them this time, then it will not work for them very good next time, especially if everyone remembers the first time when you shut them down. So part of what, a big thing of what I'm trying to do in this situation is shut it down. Here I am. I'm somebody who's exercised the freedom of speech extensively for 17 years straight. That's what I do. You want to make it look like I'm an underground terrorist, that I'm like responsible for burning all these buildings down, then fucking prove it. Because I'm fucking tired of it. So it's an important thing I could run and hide, and I'm stressed out about it, right? And my family is under attack, my extended family is under attack, my business is under attack, all this stuff, and I could run and hide and forget about it, and hope that they never indict me. Maybe they can investigate, but I didn't do anything, so hopefully they'll never indict me. Fuck that. Mm-hmm. Because if they see that I'm being investigated and that I'm scared, and the movement sees that, and all my allies and associates see that, then that's cute for them to be scared too. But if they see that I'm standing up and I'm fighting back, and I'm not stopping, and I'm going on a speaking tour, and that like I'm doing press about it, well, that's a cue too. And that cue says, like, don't take this fucking shit. This entire woo! Thing. So, I guess I would take some questions if people have questions. We also have these brochures. It outlines the situation that I just talked about, but it's also got contact information for burning books in there, so grab these. I'll put them on the front table. If anyone has a question about anything,
Well, what are you hoping to get out of your tour, and like what kind of support? You know, obviously you've been connected, but I don't know. I personally don't feel like I've been showing you the support and love that I would like to contribute personally, and also as a community, and as the, you know, being that we're such, you know, friends and neighbors and comrades. What would you want to see, or you know, as you're building this, to strengthen our networks now?
So one of the things I'm trying to do is just keep, you know, keep the word alive about it. You know, this is going to be a slow process. It's going to take years. It's already taken years. Surprisingly, I've already been dealing with this since September of 2012. So I want to make sure that people realize that it's still going. That, you know, that although it might be at moments it might not be at an exciting stage, that it's still alive and that there are progress. There's progress along the way. And so personal visits, by tours and presentations and stuff like that really help that. But also, you know, social media and online stuff and continuing articles and all that is also helpful too. But another is just what I was saying. You know, it's the reason that so much of this presentation is nuts and bolts about FOIA and like, and you go back into history about what FOIA was used for before, is because it's a how-to. I mean, it's in a way I'm trying to show people like, look, this is what's happened before, and this is what we've been able to win, and this is what we're doing now to try to fight. We've written all these letters to all these agencies, we've used FOIA in this way, we've used the state law in that way, this is what we got so far, and now we're suing, and you can't get this without, so it's a total nuts and bolts how-to.
And with the FOIA, like, what's the best case that you're hoping to get out of that, or like, how is that going to influence this?
Best case scenario is that I get, like, a lot of documents that expose a lot of stuff that, you know, that they shouldn't be doing. And that the press and the public in general is behind me. I mean, worst case scenario is that people fall to that I get all that stuff, and that people fall to the fear mongering type of, you know, atmosphere that exists, and they think, well, this person's like, he agrees with it, so he should be under investigation. But I'm hoping to sort of, in my own small way, set the clock back pre 9/11, you know, to an era of what they call like the. You know, like the post-Vietnam War syndrome, the Vietnam War syndrome era, where people were so not in support of things like the draft and like surveillance because of all the horrible stuff that happened in Vietnam. If people could see that this isn't justified, you know, that these government agencies should not be allowed to do this, we could start like changing public opinion back in that direction some, which would be very helpful. You know, surveillance technology is advancing, and our movement isn't advancing fast enough. And as you know, all this technology advances more, we're going to have less and less of the ability to actually strike blows to the system because without getting busted, you know. So the clock is ticking. In essence, we don't have time to like play around and you know and be and worry about things on a personal level. Sometimes we have to like step up and make a big deal out of it. It's actually uncomfortable for me, even though I've done all this press stuff. Like it's always been really uncomfortable for me. The first like few couple years of me being in the press office, I was behind the scenes. And the guy I was working with, Craig, was always the one who was on the news. And I would just sort of coach him, and I would produce like the independent media stuff, and and all that. And I would like do a lot of work, but I didn't want to get in front of the camera. So it's actually kind of, it's like, I had to like force myself to do that because he got really burnt out, and I, you know, it wasn't fair. So I stepped up, and then I took my turn. But like, and you know, I'm not like super psyched on having my face in the front of the newspaper. It's actually kind of uncomfortable. I just, you know, if I wasn't an activist, I'd just kind of lay low. Like, that would be more my style, but that's, I haven't had that opportunity. So I put myself out there, not for the sake of, like, advancing my, you know, glorious name.
Can I ask, Professor, I have to go to work. I'm sorry to take all the questions, and I have to go, but I do want to know this, too. Was there a significant, like, ELF members, like, they did later, like, round up some people? Like,
yeah.
Can you speak to that and, like, how they're doing and what kind of support they need?
So some of these cases were solved. Some of the ones that I showed up there were solved, and a number of others that I didn't talk about were solved. And a lot of them were solved under this Operation Backfire, the FBI's Operation Backfire, which after this, they took a cold case approach. You know, the case was, they got nowhere on it, and so they started over from scratch with a new team and a new method, and actually found this one person that they suspected, and I could go into more detail, but I don't need to. They found one person that they thought maybe might know something about it, and tricked that person into thinking that they knew everything about it in a grand jury type of setting, and that person cracked, told them everything about a whole bunch of actions that they knew about, which was unfortunate. This person was also a drug addict and in a bad place, and it was just, it was the chink in the armor that they found it, you know, and exposed, because like I said, there was no physical evidence on the scene of any of these actions. So and a lot of these people had actually in late December of 2005. So back up to 2002, that particular group, cell, so to speak, of the ELF, disintegrated over internal politics. They couldn't get along anymore. They decided that they couldn't work together anymore, and they went on with their lives. Some of them were more active than others. Some of them stopped being activists pretty much altogether. And so they had lived years after they had committed these, quote, crimes, so-called crimes, and gotten away with it, and had moved across the country, and like had no contact with each other, and all this stuff. Well, this thing happened, and that guy, you know, provided all this information, and then when they rounded all these people up, a number of them decided to cooperate, and a number decided not to. So the ones that cooperated, they decided they were afraid. Like one example of two people out of this group were facing 1,115 years plus life. Daniel McGowan, who If a Tree Falls was about, was facing 335 years plus life. So these were all very, very big cases. They had, basically all looking at life in prison. And so some people freaked out. And even though they had vowed to never turn code on each other, they did. And some people didn't. Some people, you know, stayed strong and resisted it. Daniel McGowan would be one of them, featured in If a Tree Falls. And those people who didn't cooperate actually took deals, non-cooperating plea agreements. So they admitted to what they did, but they refused to talk about anybody else. And they actually only ended up serving, like, you know, depending on who it was, 4 to 8 years in prison. Which I'm not saying that that's a walk in the park, especially Daniel, who was put in the communications management unit, the terrorist prison within a prison, which was brand new and was horrible. You know, but it's a lot less than 335 years plus life. And so there's a number of people who are considered political prisoners. Some of them are still in on related cases. Marius Mason, formerly Marie Mason, is serving 20 years. She was responsible for the Michigan State University arson against Monsanto that I showed at the very beginning of this presentation, along with maybe a half dozen other actions, which I didn't talk about. And she is about 7 or 8 years into her 20-year sentence right now, and she's in a special, the closest thing they have for a terrorist unit for females. And she has now transitioned to a male and changed her name to Marius from Marie, which is the latest on that. But, so that's one. Eric McDavid is another big case that people talk a lot about. Eric actually never did anything. He befriended a 17-year-old, I think, when he met her, female, who turned out to be an FBI agent, and they had developed a relationship over the years. This person had rented a cabin with FBI money that was rigged up with recording devices, rented cars, paid for everything, got a group of people into this cabin for like a week and a half or something like that, and tried to convince them to talk about doing sabotage actions. And they reluctantly kind of considered it. I think that that's a fair way to put it. You know, they were considering it reluctantly. This agent was like, you know, bullying and browbeating them into agreeing to do stuff that they weren't really necessarily on the level of doing. So Eric and two other people were charged with this. The two other people cooperated. I testified against Eric. Eric is doing 20 years. We're talking about maybe doing something in a cabin with an FBI agent. So those are the two biggest at the moment recent environmental political prisoner cases. But what I really also always want to point out is that this isn't just about the environmental issue. This is about all freedom struggles. Like, there are many, many political prisoners out there. There's still people in for the Panthers. Jalil Mutakim, which we mentioned this morning, who I just visited last week, is on his 42nd or 43rd year in prison right now. He's in this, you know, maximum security unit in New York State prison. So is Seth Hayes, about the same amount of time. Robert Seth Hayes, also a Panther. These are people who are right here in New York State. David Gilbert has 75 to life for driving a getaway vehicle at a political bank robbery in 1981. He will never see a parole. Boy, never get a chance for parole. And there's many, many more. And those are just some people who are within driving distance from here. There are many political
murderers who made us get so much less time.
As far as the system is concerned, they much prefer people to murder each other for no political cause whatsoever, or to rape each other for no good reason, as if there's ever a good reason. But you know, they don't really have that big a problem with that. And then they'll release you right back to your community without any rehabilitation, so you do it again. They got no problem with that. But when it comes to somebody standing up for something and actually winning some victories for a cause that means something that's important to people, well, that's about the worst thing that this government can really, you know, have to deal with. And that person is going to get a big sentence, if at all possible. So it's very important, just like it's important to resist repression, it's very important to resist the farthest end of repression, you know, which is when people are killed and when people are put in prison for long periods of time. So I encourage everyone to check out Marius Mason, Eric McDavid, any other political prisoner, Jericho. The Jericho organization has a website with a full list of political prisoners on it. There's also a group called the Anarchist Black Cross, which has an even bigger list of political prisoners on it. And there are political prisoners around the world as well. So, any other questions? Yeah, back.
Thanks a lot, and thanks for speaking out, making it really public. I was curious, because we watched If a Tree Falls a week ago at the same time, your take on, in particular, I was thinking about how they presented Superior Lumber. Mm-hmm. In that, like, I guess I had sort of a take, I thought about it like a couple days later, of being kind of sympathetic, and I'm just curious about, like, I like you showing the helicopter thing. They didn't present any of that.
Well, it's part of the reason why I put that in the presentation, because I'm somewhat bothered by the way they presented Superior Lumber. I mean, I know the filmmakers, I appreciate their work. I worked with them on the project, you know, but part of what they're trying to do is create a dramatic story where there's a lot of people can get sucked into it, so they're not trying to create like a really one-sided story with that film. So it's funny, like, I know that when the videographer took that shot, he had framed it so that you could see the logging helicopter in there. It was sort of a secret hint to the environmentalists, right? But they didn't. But that didn't end up making it into, I mean, it made it into the film visually, but there was nothing said about it. Very little was said about it, actually, in the film. But you know, that's something that they wanted to put in the film for the sake of, you know, for what that was. But to me, that's a more important part, especially after they portrayed Superior Lumber as a mom and pop company, which it
exactly
wasn't,
yeah,
right? And that, you know, it's just a nice old-time logging company, which it wasn't. I wouldn't say they went that far, but they kind of, it was a little bit in that direction, where they were trying to, you know, paint Superior Lumber as like, you know, they interviewed them sympathetically and everything, you know, which is, I mean, I don't have a problem with getting all sides of the story. I think people hopefully are smart enough to, like, decipher what they think out of that situation. And I think that the film overall was very good, you know, really helped people to understand some of the movement in some ways. But yeah, that bothered me, and that's part of the reason why I put that part in this presentation, you know, because I think it's important people realize that it's not always like the biggest name, you know. Pacific Lumber was like the biggest logging company at the time, everyone hated. It's not always the biggest name that, you know, is doing bad things. A lot of times, these smaller companies are doing really awful things too. And they might, I'm sure they're not gonna be tiny companies, but they might not be the biggest. Good example, which is highlighted a little bit in If a Tree Falls, is the Cafe West horse slaughterhouse thing. So, and I can run through that super quick. There's this place in Oregon where it's a slaughterhouse that just slaughters horse meat. It's in a small town in Oregon, and they round up horses. They were rounding up horses from Bureau of Land Management lands, public lands, federally operated lands, rounding up wild horses, and illegally, BLM employees, federal employees, were adopting these horses and then selling them to slaughter. So then when they took them to slaughter, they would get paid just like a farmer would bring his cattle to slaughter, get paid per head, right? And then when they do this slaughtering in the town, they did it like seasonally or whatever, and it would overflow the town's water system with blood. Everything would be like red, the water would be all bloody. It was really horrible. The town was protesting it for a long time. There were lawsuits against it for a long time. It went nowhere, and there was at least two really large Associated Press articles about it, which got a lot of exposure, and people were like outraged, but then there was no follow-up, especially because it had that extra element of that these people were illegally adopting these horses and then privately making money on top of doing this thing, you know, that was heinous in the first place, they were also profiting individually off of it by adopting sources and selling them. So one of the first things that the ELF did, one of the first actions it did, was go to one of these corrals that the BLM was rounding up horses with, let all the horses go, and then burn down the corral. Maybe like $200,000 damage, something like that. You know, not the hugest ELF action, but it was exciting. And the horses all ran free, which is a beautiful thing. They did another action like that later on, where they let horses out of the corral again and burnt another corral down. But in the meantime, they actually went to the horse slaughterhouse facility and burnt the whole thing down. It wasn't, again, this wasn't the biggest slaughterhouse in the country, right? I think it just slaughtered horse meat, I'm pretty sure. I could be wrong on that, but it wasn't the biggest slaughterhouse in the country. It wasn't a huge, and Cavell West was not like a household name. Nobody really knew what it was. It was just a horse slaughterhouse that like nobody even knew existed for the most part. But they completely burnt it to ground, completely destroyed it, and it shut it down. And they never rebuilt. They never got the insurance for it. You know, it was done. They couldn't slaughter horses after that. And so I mean, although that company may not have been, again, the biggest slaughterhouse in the country, they shut it down, and it was over. Right? When all the legal protest methods that had been employed failed, there was another recourse for justice, and you know, people risked their freedom and even their lives to do it, but they succeeded. And so, you know, it's not always about attacking the biggest target. Sometimes, you know, if you attack another target that's doing something maybe really bad, you know, you can have a different kind of effect. And that was one example.
What do you think about the new AG laws?
The what? The ag laws?
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, I can talk about it a little bit. So, that, you know, along with this, like, post 9/11 sort of, like, anti-human agenda, you know, pro-surveillance, anti-human agenda that the government has got going on. They have a series of laws, legislation. Like I mentioned earlier, when these private groups try to fund legislations for their interests to protect their industries, the agricultural industry has been pushing forward all these different statewide legislations and not just in the United States, but also overseas in other countries, called ag gag laws, or nicknamed ag gag laws. So basically, what it does is criminalize whistleblowing. So people who work in a facility of agriculture, and that can be not just like a slaughterhouse or a farm, but that includes fracking. That's agriculture. Any resource extraction is considered agriculture. Or logging, that's considered agriculture. So in any of those situations that are considered agriculture, it criminalizes whistleblowing. To the extent of, you know, if somebody is caught taking photos of something, or with a camera on the premise while they're working, or even if they don't work there, that is really bad, you know, all of a sudden it's a huge crime. Where before, like, whistleblowing was a big part of, like, how we found out about things. People are championed for, like, exposing companies for doing horrible things. They're trying to turn the table on that, along with this whole wave of, you know, fear-mongering that's coming post 9/11.
They're criminalizing the picture, not the act.
Yeah. Yeah, and so the person who actually took the picture is probably going to do a lot more jail time than the people who were, oh, I don't know, dumping toxic waste that they took the picture of, right? So these things are being pushed forward in a number of states. Will Potter, who is the author of Green is New Red, is really spearheading a lot of action against that. That's kind of inspiring in some ways. And I encourage you to check out his website, greenisthenewred.com. But a lot of this legislation is failing, but don't get too excited about that. Some of it's passing, and if you look at it historically, with the Animal Enterprise Protection Act and then the Animal Enterprise Terrorism Act, those things failed along the way too. And what they do is they learn why that failed, they amend the legislation, and then they pass it again with a different twist so that it passes through the next time. And then once they get that, they realize, well, we can get a little farther, change from Animal Enterprise Protection to Animal Enterprise Terrorism. And so they just keep building on this legislation, further criminalizing protest and dissent. So, I mean, I think ag gag stuff is horrible. Will Potter's challenging some of it right now. He's renting, he bought like a drone helicopter, like a remote control drone helicopter with cameras on it, GoPros mounted on it, like flying it into stockyards and like filming stuff without actually being there. So, I mean, he could get arrested and charged with stuff, and he's willing to take that risk. And there was a big like Kickstarter type thing that he got a ton of money to do this. So there's a big movement against it, and I think that that's a big thing to pay attention to. Along the same lines of everything I'm talking about tonight, you know, they pass this legislation, it puts us back a huge step, you know. I mean, if you can't even go into a place and take pictures, then what happens if you go into it and let the horses go, right?
that new movie that just came out, Conspiracy. You've seen that yet? Mm-hmm. He was barely even able to show any. It was majorly subdued. But yeah, it's a new one about the, you know, how, you know, animals and all the agriculture is destroying, mm-hmm, you know, environment more than anything else. Mm-hmm. But yeah, it's a neat movie just came out.
It's called Conspiracy.
Conspiracy.
Okay. Yeah. Cool.
Just going off of what Henny was saying about the film, I don't know if you want to go too far in that, but can you talk anything about the agent that's interviewed in that film? Because he...
Which one?
The guy that says, like, you know, you can look at people and you start off with this job and you're like, you know, black and white.
The older guy?
Yeah, and then at the end he's saying, you know, it's like shades of gray. And just like thinking about stuff in Rochester, like there was a prosecutor, a DA, Mike Green, who is now some sort of governmental head of some bureau in New York State. And there was a kid here who shot a cop, and he was, like, gung-ho to have that kid, like, put away for decades, you know, like, so horrifying. And after he was sentenced, he went on the press and said, yeah, he was a troubled kid, he had a lot of issues. And it's like, flipped a switch. He went from, like, extreme prosecutorial monster to, like, yeah, like this prosecutor became human. And I'm wondering if the agent portrayed in the film really had the thoughts that he's portrayed as having, or if that was just a switch that he...
Well, it could have just been something to make him look good.
Yeah.
You know, who knows? But, and I wasn't present at those interviews.
Of course,
But what it immediately makes me think of when I saw the film, too, is that, like, this stuff isn't... It's not personal vendettas, it's systemic, right? I mean, like, this. There's cases where people act, and I know of some of these cases personally, where people act as if it's a personal vendetta, and they put a lot of extra time and energy into solving a particular case, or criminal, or being angry at a person, or prosecuting a person, or whatever, and there's many cases of that. But the core of it is that it's systemic. Like, that maybe that person goes home and is, like, a nice father. You know, who knows? It's not that they're necessarily a horrible person all the time. It's, you know, that's what their job is, right? And, I mean, I know a number of cases where prosecutors actually didn't even want to take on a case. Mm-hmm. Like Nate Buckley's case in Buffalo, if you're familiar with the police brutality case in Buffalo, a while ago, Nate Buckley's case, it actually came out that the prosecutor who was on the case didn't even want to have it, didn't even want to prosecute, but the higher-up person within the DA's office or whatever was saying, you have to do this case and you have to win it. You know, so it's, you know, it's a job, it's systemic.
There's other forces working on that.
Yeah, yeah, and, you know, it's not like these people are all horrible. You know, the FBI agents that I got to know personally in Oregon, pretty horrible, right? But how many didn't I know? Like, a lot. They have a lot of employees, they have a huge payroll. It's gotten even bigger now, so much bigger now. You know, so, and it's not about these people, it's not like an action movie where somebody's just evil. Like, this is a systemic thing, you know? And essentially, somebody asked me a question yesterday at a similar presentation about that, and I remember my answer was just like, you know, that's, they were like surprised. The question was like, I'm surprised that the FBI would like do tens of thousands of pages, you know, into you. And of course I'm surprised too, but the reality is that that's their job. Like, I don't, you know, if you understand what they do and what they've done historically, I mean, yeah, they do sometimes, they bust the mob, and, like, on occasion they'll bust some, like, right-wing extremist, quote, extremist types or whatever, you know, but essentially their whole history from the very beginning, I mean, J. Edgar Hoover started the group up, you know, the whole thing has been political repression of the left. That's really what it is. You know, they try to make it look fair and balanced by doing some non-political cases and other, like, and other crimes or maybe right-wing political cases, but, like, that's what they are. They're the political police, you know, and when any movement, they'll ignore you until you start getting to the point where you're actually having some major victories. And then at that point, it really doesn't even matter if you're doing anything illegal or not. I'm not doing anything illegal, right? I'm exercising freedom of speech, freedom of the press, freedom of association. And I've been doing it for 17 years, and they know damn well by now that that's what I do, you know. But that doesn't matter. They still allocate tens of thousands of pages and all the resources that go along with that to monitoring. You know, so I just think that, you know, you can't forget that, especially the FBI, but any really like law enforcement agency, like part of their purpose, if not a good part of it, is specifically to deal with people like us that are trying to change problems. You know, the government in general works very explicitly for corporations at this point in time. You know, and that might be a shock to some people, but it doesn't shock me at all anymore. This is like, I just understand, like, that's the way it works. Corporations, like, the media works for corporations. Corporations pay the advertising, the entire budget of the media. Who do they work for? The corporations. It's the same thing with the government. You know, the corporations are the lifeblood of the government. They do all the lobbying. All these politicians are in, you know, in the pockets of these corporations because they owe debts by lobbying, and they're working for a corporate agenda. And so when it comes to something like the FBI, which is told what to do by the government, told what to focus on by the government, you know, and then you've got a group that is causing significant losses, profit losses, to say the fracking industry or whatever, like, that group is going to get targeted. Even if they're not doing anything illegal, they're going to get a massive amount of repression and surveillance pumped on them, because the interests, you have to see the reality behind the curtain of whose interest is being threatened, and then who gets focused all that, you know, governmental attention on. And, you know, with all these situations with the Earth Liberation Fund, I mean, you're causing, you know, hundreds of millions of dollars in damages to some of the biggest, like, pollution industries that exist, you know, and resource extraction industries that are out there. And they're lobbying, and all this stuff happens, and you're like, oh, wow, they sent, you know, Eric McDavid to prison for 20 years. Well, you know what, that's horrible, and I hate that, you know, and I want to see Eric free, but at the same time, like, it's almost naive not to realize that that is exactly what they plan to do. That is the whole point of their existence. That is the whole point why these agencies keep getting their budgets increased. There's the whole point about, like, putting all this money into terrorism, all this hysteria into terrorism post 9/11, is because for a little bit of time there, it seemed like the movement was about to win something. You know, in the late 90s or whatever, and that's nothing compared to what happened in the 60s. But in that period, the whole WTO got shut down, the whole anti-globalization thing came up, anarchism rose up again. It was like a powerful, you know, movement that was being built. And this is the response. And I think that people can, like, get confused and think that it's about some planes crashing into a building or something like that, but no. You know, a lot of this is about, like, you know, they're taking advantage of the situation that happened, but a lot of this is about, like, you know what? These people are getting out of hand. You know, we got to put them back in line. And, you know, and unfortunately, one of the big lessons for me is that, like, you know, I thought that we were winning too. Like, I thought that we had like a, you know, a lot of victories, and we were going somewhere good, and we were, but it's relative. Like, we thought, you know, that to say generally, you know, we thought that the government was exercising all the tools that it had to exercise, when in reality it was only exercising the ones that it could most comfortably exercise. When it comes down to a situation where they're more threatened, then they bring out the big guns, you know, and then you have Fred Hampton drugged, murdered, and he couldn't even get out of his bed. When the gun's going off in his room, he couldn't get up out of his bed because the FBI agent had drugged him. So he's drugged in his bed in the middle of the night, shot point blank, and he's dead, right? And that's nothing compared to, like, how the CIA operates in many other countries, or how many other governments operate, and stuff that we don't even know about. It happens right here in this country. And if it gets down to that, where we're victorious enough, which we're unfortunately very far away from, but, you know, if it gets down to the point where we're winning on that level of actually threatening the power structure that we're complaining about so much, then that's the kind of thing that we're going to be dealing with on a regular basis. You know, and we're not just going to be doing it by sabotaging the companies. You know, unfortunately, you know, they don't give up that way. They'll do the nicest, most comfortable thing to stop you at any moment, you know, the safest thing to stop you at any moment, but when that doesn't work, they'll do something less safe and less comfortable. And then as it gets more and more down the line, you end up in a war type of situation, right? So, I mean, I think that there's a lot of lessons to be learned from the ELF, but for me, that's one of them, is that, like, okay, we had a good idea, it was working well, there were a lot of wins, but, you know, we weren't ready to go as far as we needed to go. And, you know, and realistically, the good people aren't just... Good people are just not as likely to be ready to do horrible things because they're good people, you know? And the whole essence of what we stand for is because we're good people. We want to fight for justice. And so it's kind of like a bad situation where you're fighting an enemy that will do anything to stop you, so you have to kind of become a lot like that enemy, and it's really hard and unfortunate and uncomfortable and not likely to happen. So it's just...
Do you think this social media is the next big arm of the independent movement? I mean, because like the dollar, people spending the dollar is really what controls everything. The people, you can get people to stop spending their money on things that they really care about, because they don't people think about what they're buying. If you can get people to stop buying, that's like the hugest thing that the world can change with. You know? People don't realize how much just going to the store and buying something makes a difference. You know, and like, I see where like, in certain situations, you're able to bring like huge change, you know? Mm-hmm. But, like you say, with the government, you know, and with the corporations backing them, mm-hmm. all they need to do is have, you know, a group. They could literally make them disappear, you know? There's so much power that they have.
Yeah.
So, like, but what they can't control is you not buying something, you know? If you decide not to buy something, you got to change the mindset.
You've got to realize that whatever you do that's effective, they'll criminalize at some point. You know, I think that the social, you know, the internet and social media and stuff is like very powerful, and the government is putting a lot of energy into that and resources into that, increasing them out. But so that, on one hand, I totally think that, you know, there's a lot of power there, and people are fighting for the autonomy and that constantly. And if you look at Jeremy Hammond's case, I'm super inspired by that. He hacked, like, and if you're not familiar, there's a lot of this stuff. Like, if you get an FBI file back now, like, most of the recent ones don't even contain telephone information, telephone tapping information, because they're just subcontracting that out to private companies. Tons of the stuff is now being subcontracted out to private companies. These private companies are corporations, so they essentially operate with immunity just like any other corporation does. A corporation might get fined, but the individuals will not be held accountable because it's a corporate person. So, there's this company called Stratfor, which is one of a number that is, you know, monitoring activists for contract, not just for the government, but also for private companies. Like, for example, Monsanto owns the majority of stock in what used to be called Blackwater, which is, you know, I think it now they're called the Academy, or maybe they've changed their name since then. I can't remember, but they keep changing their name because Blackwater has such a bad reputation. But, you know, like, why would Monsanto be hiring a mercenary, but buying out a mercenary, international mercenary, like, murderous, you know, because they have contracts with them to spy on activists, and everyone hates Monsanto, so, like, you know, so it's a big, good investment for them. But, so Hammond hacked into Stratfor, Strategic Forensics, which is known as Stratfor. He's a computer hacker, and he used WikiLeaks to expose all the surveillance that this private company was doing, and sort of broke open the shell on this whole thing about private spying through corporate contracts and government contracts. And he's now serving 10 years in prison because he got busted for it, but not until after he released the documents. But I think that there's tons of power in internet stuff. There's a lot of power in social media. But at the same time, I think it always was, like, revolution always boils down to the same thing, you know? It's a power struggle, you know, and we can earn a lot, we can win a lot of ground here, we can win a lot of ground with Occupy for a few months, and we can, like, win some ground with Ferguson for a little bit, and blah, 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 and it's gonna keep going that way, and those things are all awesome, but at the end of the day, to get what we all are really, like, fighting for, it's just like any other revolution that has ever happened. It's not gonna change, you know, it's just the same. It's the same scenario. It comes down to, like, a big cost. A lot of dedication, a lot of loss, long hard fight.
The media say crack was behind something, you know, some environmental issue or whatever. Everybody put out a media thing, no one buy any crack. Mm-hmm. You know, they could literally destroy a whole company by just the world just not buying any more.
Yeah,
whatever.
But at the same time, they have all these tricks, right? I mean, like, you know how the natural foods industry, like, used to be owned by a bunch of small companies? A lot of them are, like, small, old, like, fundamentalist Christian companies. But they did, like, natural stuff for decades since the 70s. Now it's all owned by Kraft, which is owned by Philip Morris. Philip Morris. Right, Kraft owns Philip Morris owns Kraft. So they do shadow companies, and they do corporate hiding. And it won't say Kraft on your box of Kashi, but, you know, that's what you're buying. So they, you know, they'll find ways to hide what they do, or they'll close a company and open another one, because it's just about making money.
Yeah.
You know, so it's like, yeah, we can do a lot of wins, but, you know, there's a bigger picture that we also need to be working on at the same time.
Yeah.
You know? we don't take out capitalism, which is the motivating factor behind pretty much everything that we're all fighting against all the time is capitalism. If we don't actually address that, then we're just fighting all, Yeah, that's a big thing. And issues for me personally, like I'm big on issues that get closer to capitalism than other ones. Like campaign financing is great. I mean, it's a really awful element of capitalism that needs to be fought. Unfortunately, there's not a lot of exciting activism happening around that issue. Part of what I thought was exciting about ELF, and one of the communiques I've read mentioned this, is that they were clearly moving towards fighting capitalism in particular. They said that in one of the communiques said and this year we hope to see an escalation of actions against capitalism in the industry, right? Like specifically addressing that root cause instead of just saying this one horse slaughterhouse or this one ski resort or whatever.
Thank you so much, Leslie.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thanks for having me.
The Earth Liberation Front. You can go to Senate hearings, wait till they call your name. My hat is off to anyone with the will to play that game. But if you want to know the truth, what warms my aching heart is to see the masked Avengers come to tear the road apart. So here's a toast to the night, three cheers and a grunt. Hey, 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 oh! To the Earth Liberation Front.